Today's topic of homosexuality, this is a sensitive one. You know, it's a deeply personal one. You know, as I said, if you got loved ones who experience these attractions, you want to express God's love for them. But sometimes you feel like, man, anytime I try to explain it, I just feel like I'm making more of an enemy than a friend. You know, if they experience same-sex attractions, like, what is God's plan for their life? I mean, are they supposed to live a life of just misery and loneliness and depression and self-denial? Like, you know, where's the joy? Where's the freedom in that? And I think if you experience same-sex attractions, the world will essentially tell you, you pretty much only have two options in your life that you can pick from, okay? Option number one is you can hide in the closet out of fear and shame, because if anyone knew you had those feelings, they would hate you and be bigoted against you. Or if you don't want to live in a closet, then, and who would? Well, come out of the closet, embrace your sexual attractions as your identity, and just forget about God, the church, and the Bible, and you do whatever you want. So gay pride or gay shame, what's your choice? Now, imagine you feel a little stuck in the middle here. Well, wait a minute, I don't want to throw away God, but seriously, like, shame? Why should I have to live in shame of an attraction I never chose to begin with? It's not like I woke up this morning, hey, I'll be attracted to these people today. It's not some conscious choice. I mean, are people going to hate you for having these feelings? Well, unfortunately, yeah. I mean, some people will. You see them on TV. They got their protest signs. They're like, God hates gays. I'm like, actually, God hates your stupid sign. Okay, that's what he hates. But the problem is, fanatics like that make the whole world think that if you believe in traditional marriage, you, my friend, are nothing but a hateful, homophobic bigot. But this isn't true. In fact, a couple months ago, I was buying a frame at a store of a painting this artist gave me of Pope John Paul II. And, you know, I put the frame on the counter and the guy looked at it at the store and he's like, oh, Pope John Paul II. He said, I used to be a Catholic boy, but the church doesn't want me anymore. I said, oh, what do you mean the church doesn't want you? And he opened up to me about homosexuality. And I said, no, the church wants you. This is your home. God wants you. God loves you. I love you. He's like, what church do you go to? And yeah, that's a great conversation. You know, 2 weeks later, I came back. I'm like, hey, you know, Eric, how are you? He said, you remembered my name. I said, yeah, how are you? And he said, you know, okay. And we started talking. 10 minutes into the conversation, his eyes start kind of turning red. His tear just came down his cheek. He said, can I hug you? I said, absolutely. He came around the counter, gave us a big hug. My son, John Paul, was there. I'm like, John Paul, give him a hug. My son's hugging his leg and I'm hugging him. And people in line are like, what's going on up there? But driving home that day, I was just wondering, like, what was it in the conversation that hit him? And I think what it was is that I didn't tolerate him at all. I just loved him. Loved him enough to tell him the truth. Like, look, bud, your sexual attractions like mine are not our identities. If anyone in the world defines their identity by their sexual attractions, life is going to get really confusing real fast. Because, I mean, you think about it. If I see some stunningly beautiful woman at some airport somewhere who's not my wife, and I'm attracted to a woman who's not my wife, is that attraction my identity? No. If I see some pornographic billboard and I think she's pretty, like, is that my identity? No. Am I an adulterosexual or pornosexual? No. All of us experience these attractions, but our attractions are not things we deliberately choose. They're experiences that happen to us. And so our sexual attractions are not our identity. But the world will say otherwise. The world, no. You are either L or G or B or T or Q or whatever the acronym may be. That is who you are. But the church offers us kind of a different anthropology, that there's not 58 different types of people like Facebook says. There's really only three. Because a person is a rational being. So you have divine persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You have angelic persons who are the holy angels, the fallen angels, the demons. And then you have human persons made male and female in the image and likeness of God. And that's it. So if you experience homosexual attractions, to me, your identity isn't L or G or B. Like, your identity is you're a beloved son or daughter of God. It is the deepest truth of your identity. And I think this is an important piece because our behavior will always flow from our identity. And if I think my identity is my sexual attractions, then my behavior is just going to flow from that. And I think someone who understood this well was Mother Teresa of Calcutta. In fact, I had a professor once, a Monsignor, who lived with the Missionaries of Charity for a long time and knew Mother very well. And he had mentioned to me once that the media apparently was interviewing Mother Teresa on all kinds of different hot button topics, and they brought up the issue of homosexuality. So Mother Teresa, with regard to the homosexual this, homosexual that, and she stopped and she said, you know what? I don't like the word homosexual. And they're like, oh, Mother Teresa hates gays. She's like, no, no, no. She said, for the rest of the interview, I would ask that you would refer to them as friends of Jesus. Now go on. And they're like, okay, well, with regard to the friends of Jesus here in Calcutta, and for the rest of the interview, she held them to that, that that's the deepest truth of who these individuals are. And now you may be thinking, okay, well, fine and good. You know, I experience same-sex attractions. I'm a friend of Jesus. But really, like, where does that leave me? You know, am I basically have to live without love? Basically, obey the church and live a life of misery and loneliness and repression and isolation, or disobey the church and go to hell. Like, are those really my options? In fact, I read of a gentleman who had experienced same-sex attractions and spoke of this internal dilemma. And here's what he said. He said, a lot of people in my position feel like religion presents them with a choice between death by damnation or death by desolation. What I would say to someone in that position is this: start by coming to God and his church and just take it from there. The truth is that doing things that please God does not result in a life of desolation. Now, as surprising as this sounds, I would propose today that the Catholic Church does not forbid same-sex couples to love one another. I would actually propose that the Catholic Church is the only institution still around that's actually encouraging these individuals to truly love each other. Now, I know that might sound strange, but I think it's because our world really needs a redemption of the word love. The world has told us, look, sex equals love, and if you can't express love in a genital way, then your ability, your freedom to give and receive love is being taken from you. But I think what's being missing from this picture is that abstinence is often a tremendous expression of love. And the inability to practice abstinence is often a sign of a lack of love, an indication that love has not matured. And you can see this in different ways in life. I mean, take, for example, some high school boy, and he wants to sleep with his girlfriend, and she's kind of worried about it. Well, you know, I might get pregnant. My mom might find out. Does he really love me? But the boy insists, no, no, no. If you loved me, you'd give this to me. If you really love me, then you'd let me have this. It's not that big of a deal. Come on, you know, we'll be safe. You could see his refusal to be abstinent is not a sign of how much he loves her. It's a sign of how little that he loves her. But if he were to say, look, yeah, I'm tempted to do this with you, but I love you too much to do that with you. I want to fall in love with you for the right reasons. And so tonight, my abstinence with you is going to be a greater expression of love than making love, because I want to do what's best for you, not just what feels good in the moment. You would see his abstinence is an authentic expression of love. Take example in marriage. Let's say a husband is on a business trip away from his wife. Well, he's better be abstinent that night. And his abstinence is a sign of his fidelity. If he comes home and his wife is exhausted and tired, maybe another night of abstinence. Why? As an expression of love. You have people who maybe choose the priesthood, religious life. Their celibacy and the abstinence lived through that is not a negation of love. It's not a sign that sexuality is bad and dirty. It's you only offer a gift if it has great value. And to offer up the gift of your sexuality to God is a tremendous gift that frees them to serve the church. And so you can see in all these different instances, abstinence can actually be an expression of love. I think the world has a hard time understanding this because the world obviously has pretty much sexualized everything, right? I mean, you sexualize your Doritos, you sexualize your deodorant. I mean, everything's sexual. Cheeseburgers, very sexual. I mean, it's to the point of, it's ridiculous. I was at a hardware store and I saw a magazine that says, now, if you buy the magazine, you will learn blueprints to build sexy shutters for your house. And I'm like, stop it. Like, stop. Like, I don't need sexy window treatments. I mean, could you imagine a friend was walking through your kitchen this afternoon and, you know, they look at it and they're like, whoa, like you have really sexy shutters. You'd be like, you're a really weird friend, but this is what's going on. Our products are getting over-sexualized. Our identity is getting over-sexualized. I mean, when I have people read my biography before a talk, I don't have them say, now our speaker today is Jason and he is straight. It's like, dude, look, if I'm straight, like if I'm a book, that's on page like 213. That's not the cover story. There's a whole lot more to me as a human being than who I happen to be sexually attracted to. And so these labels, whether they be LGBT, straight, whatever, are, I think, just too narrow to define the fullness of the human person. But the world wants us to sexualize our very identity. I think relationships are getting over-sexualized. In fact, I remember a girl gave me a magazine once called Complete Woman Magazine. And in it, there was an article on how to know, you know, when to break up with a girl, you know, and one guy says, well, you know, my rule is it's over whenever she starts asking me to help with laundry or pay the rent. I don't do laundry. That's the time to break it off. You know, another guy said, you know, I had to break up with this girl I really love because, you know, we didn't have enough sex. And the lack of sex, he said, nearly killed me. So apparently he was rushed to the hospital. I don't know if they almost did an autopsy or what, but this idea that if it's not being sexually expressed, that I'm not getting love. Like, relationships have been over-sexualized. Friendships now, I think, are the latest casualty. A couple guys hang out a lot, people get suspicious. Like, you guys hanging out a lot, you guys having a bromance over there? Like, no, we're having a masculine friendship. Well, I've never heard of that before. Sounds suspicious to me. You know, and you, so we've lost even the idea of a chaste friendship, you know, but I think the real key here is that attractions are getting over sexualized. All over the world, students come to me and say, a girl will say, Jason, look, I'm really confused because, look, I think I'm straight. My friends think I'm a, you know, bi, so I'm concluding I'm lesbian. I'm just trying to figure it out. And I'll say, what's going on? And she'll say, well, you know, there's the boys in my school, they're just immature and they're gross and they grope you in the hallway and they're just really repulsive. But there's a girl on my campus. I don't know. I come alive in her presence and we can talk for hours on end and she's beautiful and she's funny and she's smart. My friends are telling me this is a girl crush, so we should experiment together and I don't know what to think. And I said to her, look, I don't know if anyone's just not told you this before. You're supposed to be repulsed by everything repulsive. You're supposed to be attracted to everything attractive. So your friend here, her wit, her charm, her beauty, doesn't that all draw you to her? She said, it does. I said, look, I go to a Bible study. There's an 85-year-old man in our class with a gigantic beard, and I'm completely attracted to this guy. I mean, his holiness, his wisdom, his wit, his humor. I just want to be around the guy. Because guess what? Not every human attraction is a sexual attraction. And I'm telling you, this girl's eyes lit up. And she said, I have never thought about it like that before. That makes so much sense. Now, obviously, it isn't always that cut and dry, but the point is, I remember reading one guy, and he lived a very promiscuous homosexual lifestyle with different guys. And then after years of this, it just dawned on him. He said, after all this hooking up with guys and the apps and all this stuff at the park and the clubs, and he said, it finally dawned on me that I was never homosexual. And these are his words. He said, I finally realized I was homo-emotional. That I was longing for the affection, the attention, the approval, the admiration that I just never got from my own dad. And the world essentially taught me to sexualize my problems, but I was just burying them. In fact, I remember meeting a young woman after one of the talks I did at a high school, and she came up and introduced me to her girlfriend. And, you know, we had a very pleasant conversation for probably a good hour and a half. And during the conversation, all kinds of different topics came up. And I had asked her, you know, have you ever dated guys before? And she's like, oh, yeah, I used to date guys, but I'm not into that, you know. And I'm like, did anything ever happen? I'm just curious. Anything ever happened that just kind of turned you off from guys? And she said, no. I was born lesbian. And I said, okay, well, just so nothing ever kind of made you say, I'm throwing the towel, I'm done with this. And she got kind of quiet. And she said, well, I've been raped 4 times, if that's what you mean. And for this poor girl, lesbianism had become a shield for her heart because she knew exactly what men had to offer, and now she discovered a way to keep them at bay. Now, I'm not going to imply from this that if you experience homosexual attractions, you must have a horrible relationship with your dad. Oh, you must have been sexually abused. That's where it's all coming from. No, it is harmful to try to approach this deeply personal situation with some little cookie cutter approach. Well, this must be where it came from. The origins of human attraction, in my opinion, are as unique as the human person themselves. And so you need to enter into the human person to understand where are these things coming from. But the point is that not all attractions are sexual in nature. But if we believe that they are, and then we'll think that, well, my identity is only going to be fulfilled by acting these out in a sexual way. And if we do start experimenting, naturally bonding is going to ensue, and it'll only further reinforce the notion that this is who I